In this lecture, we'll focus on section 9.3 of Dummett and Foot. We'll start just by noting that when R is an integral domain, R bracket X is also an integral domain. And with an integral domain, we have this field, the field of fractions, containing a subring isomorphic to it. And we know that if F is the field of fractions, then F bracket X is Euclidean domain, so it's a PID, and so it's a UFD. So we have this ring R, and we have its field of fractions, and we have F bracket X is Euclidean domain. So if we have a polynomial P of X with coefficients in R, then we can also think of it as an element of F bracket X, because R occurs as a subring of its field of fractions. So that means that we can take this polynomial P of X, think of it as an element of F bracket X, but F bracket X is a UFD. So we can factor P of X uniquely as a product of irreducible elements in F bracket X. So remember, in here, we have all these polynomials whose coefficients are not just in R, but are actually in F. So the question is, we have this polynomial that has coefficients in R, so it's in R bracket X. What can we say about factorizations in R bracket X? So factoring P of X as a product of other polynomials, not in this bigger ring, F bracket X, but in R bracket X. And the main theorem that we want to prove in this lecture is that R is a UFD if and only if R bracket X is a UFD. So if R has nice factorization properties, then so does the polynomial ring R bracket X. And one direction is pretty straightforward, and the other direction will be the subject of most of this lecture. So we'll do the easy direction here. And suppose that R bracket X is a UFD. So first, I mean, why might you think that this is the easier direction? R is a subring of R bracket X. Elements of R occur in R bracket X as polynomials of degree zero. So if you know that everything in R bracket X factors uniquely in R bracket X, then because R occurs in a natural way as a subring of R bracket X, that's a hint that that tells you something about factorizations in R already. So okay, we have R, elements of R occur in R bracket X as polynomials of degree zero. So you take one of these polynomials of degree zero and a non-zero non-unit element that is a polynomial of degree zero, so a non-zero non-unit element of R, these elements factor uniquely in R bracket X into a product of irreducible elements in R bracket X up to associates. Okay, so what is true about the irreducibles that occur in that factorization? Well, since the degree of the product of two polynomials is the sum of their degrees when they're both non-zero polynomials, because R bracket X is an integral domain, these degrees add. That means that if you have a degree zero polynomial and you factor it into a product of irreducible elements, well, the degrees of those irreducible elements will add together. So every one of these irreducible factors has to also have degree zero. But that means, what are you getting? You have this factorization in R bracket X, but the only irreducibles that occur in that factorization are elements of R bracket X of degree zero, which means that they're actually elements of the ring R itself, because the degree zero elements exactly correspond to the elements of R. So this factorization in R bracket X, which is unique up to associates, gives a factorization in R. So the uniqueness of this factorization in R bracket X means that there couldn't be like a different factorization in as a product of irreducible elements of R. So R is a UFD as well. All right, so the whole rest of the lecture, the focus is going to be on showing that if R is a UFD, then R bracket X is a UFD. So I think it's clear why this should be the more challenging direction. Here you know that elements in R factor nicely, which tells you that the elements of degree zero in R bracket X will factor nicely. But there are a whole bunch of other elements of positive degree in R bracket X. And just from the beginning, we don't necessarily know anything about the factorizations of those elements. All right, so I'll pause and erase, and then we'll start discussing this main question of this lecture. We'll next recall something from the previous lecture. This is proposition 2 in section 9.1 that gives us a relation between ideals in R and a certain kind of ideal in R bracket X. So let's say I is an ideal in R, and let's use parentheses I or I bracket X to denote the ideal in R bracket X consisting of all polynomials whose coefficients are all in the ideal I. Then we can understand the quotient of R bracket X by this ideal. This is isomorphic to R mod I bracket X. Okay, and one consequence that we saw here is that if I is prime in R, that means R mod I is an integral domain. So R mod I bracket X is also an integral domain. That means that the ideal that we quotiented by over here is also prime in R bracket X. So this ideal I bracket X is prime in R bracket X. Okay, so we're gonna use this in this lecture. So I wanted to state it again. And remember, one of the main questions that we started with is, okay, you have this integral domain R, you have R bracket X, you have this field of fractions F, you have F bracket X, which you know is UFD. So if you have a polynomial that's in R bracket X, you can think of it as an element in F bracket X, factor it in this UFD. What does that factorization tell you about factorizations in R bracket X? And Gauss's lemma is closely related to that question exactly. So when R is a UFD, let's say R is a UFD and F is its field of fractions and P is a polynomial in R bracket X. If P of X is irreducible in F bracket X, then P of X is reducible in R bracket X. So let me just say that again. If P of X is reducible in this bigger ring where it has many, many more polynomials in it, if it factors as a product of two things of lower degree in F bracket X, then in fact, it already factors when you restrict yourself to this much smaller set of polynomials that have coefficients in R and not in this larger field F. Okay, so let me say this more precisely. Suppose you have a factorization, P of X equals A of X times B of X, two elements in F bracket X. Then you can use this factorization in F bracket X to get a factorization in R bracket X. So there exists some non-zero element in your field, R, such that R times capital A is equal to little a of X, which has coefficients in R, not just in this field F, but the coefficients now actually live in R. And R inverse times this capital B of X equals some little b of X, which also has coefficients now in R. So capital A times capital B is little a times little b. So P of X is little a of X times little b of X. This is a factorization now in R bracket X. Okay. So first, what I'll point out is dominant foot state this a little differently in a way that I find a little confusing. What they say is there are non-zero elements R and S in F such that R times capital A equals little a and S times capital B equals little b. But then there's a unit that's missing, that's floating around here somewhere, because if P of X equals capital A times capital B and also equals little a times little b, then there's an R times S out in front here, and R times S has to be equal to one because we already know that P of X equals capital A times capital B. Okay, so this is like a really minor point. Okay, so let's also just look at an example when R is Z and F is Q. So like X squared is a polynomial with coefficients in Z. We can factor it in Q bracket X in a lot of different ways. One way we could factor it is as 2X times 1/2X. These are both polynomials in F bracket X, in Q bracket X in this case. And what Gauss's lemma says is we have this factorization in F bracket X. There exists some element in Q where R times the first thing is actually has coefficients in Z, and the inverse of R times the second thing actually has coefficients also in Z. So what's happening here? So I mean, it is true that 2x already has coefficients in Z, but 1/2x doesn't. So if we multiply capital A by 1/2, then R inverse is 2. And now 1/2 a of x equals x, which we can take as little a, 2b of x equals x, which we can take as little b, and x squared equals x times x is a factorization in Z bracket x. So in the statement of Gauss's lemma, there exists some non-zero R in F. That R doesn't necessarily have to be in the ring R. The R really is a non-zero element in the field that allows you to multiply by R here, by R inverse here, and get two polynomials with coefficients in R. You don't know if there exists an element R in the ring R that satisfies this condition, but you do know that there's one in the bigger field F. Okay, so again, kind of a minor point, but I wanted to emphasize that with this example here. Okay, so I'll pause and erase, and then we'll prove Gauss's lemma. Let's see the proof of Gauss's lemma. So we'll start with a factorization of P of X in F bracket X. So remember, we want to suppose that P of X is reducible in F bracket X, which means we can write it as a product of two non-zero, non-unit elements. So what does it mean to be a non-unit in F bracket X? It just means you're not a constant polynomial, right? So the units in F bracket X are the units in F, which are everything in F except zero. So A and X and B of X are non-constant polynomials. Okay, any element in F bracket X, well, its coefficients are in F, but where do those elements of F come from? They come from quotients of elements in R. Everything is of the form A over B, where B is a non-zero element of R and A is any element of R. So that means that by taking the denominators of all of the coefficients of a polynomial in F bracket X, we can factor out the largest one and write A of X as 1 over something, let's say D prime, times A prime of X, where A prime of X has coefficients that are actually in R, and D prime is actually in R. So maybe the coefficients of this capital A are in F because D prime doesn't divide all the coefficients in A prime of X, but that's okay. We can like pull out the largest denominator, or the, you know, we can pull out all the denominators and write our polynomial in F bracket X as 1 over something in R times something in R bracket X. So this is the big idea here. We're going to clear these denominators in this factorization. We'll write this as 1 over something times something in R bracket X, write B as 1 over something times something in R bracket X. And what we get is D times P of X equals A prime of X times B prime of X, where D is some non-zero element in the ring. And now P of X, A prime of X, B prime of X, these are now all polynomials in R bracket X. Okay, so if D is a unit, we're done, because what we were trying to do is write P of X as a product of two polynomials that are not units, so they're not constant, in R bracket X. And it's clear that this process of clearing denominators doesn't change the degrees at all. So because capital A and capital B were non-constant polynomials, so are A prime and B prime. Okay, so the only issue is this D over on the left-hand side. Here we're factoring D times P of X, and we really want P of X itself. So if D is a unit, we're done, because we can multiply both sides by D inverse, some elements in R. But what if D is not a unit? So because we know that R is a UFD, We can write D as a product of irreducibles in R as P1 times P2 times M times Pn, not necessarily distinct units. And now let's look at this first factor, irreducible factor of D, P1. P1 is irreducible, and in a UFD, irreducible implies prime. So the ideal generated by P1 in R is a prime ideal. So, okay, we saw this proposition from before that because the ideal generated by P1 is prime, so is the ideal of all coefficients in R bracket X with, the ideal of all polynomials in R bracket X, all of whose coefficients lie in this prime ideal, P1. So this is a prime ideal in R bracket X. And if you take the quotient of R by the ideal generated by P1 in R bracket X, because P1 is a prime element, this is an integral domain. So here, we're just recalling this stuff from before. And now, so we have this equation, and we can reduce both sides of this equation modulo the ideal generated by P1. So this is an equation in R bracket X. We can take the quotient, look at the image of both sides of this equation in the quotient by this ideal P1 times R bracket X, right? This prime ideal in R bracket X. Okay, so what does that give us? Well, P1 divides the left-hand side, right? So all of the coefficients over here are certainly divisible by P1. So we just get zero over on the left-hand side. And over on the right-hand side, what do we get? Well, we get something. We get the image under this homomorphism where you take each coefficient and reduce modulo P1. And we get the image of A prime times the image of B prime. And that's equal to zero. But this quotient is an integral domain. So that means that either the image of A prime is zero or the image of B prime is zero in this ring. R mod P1 R bracket X. Okay, so what does that mean? So that means that we do this thing where we reduce each coefficient modulo the ideal generated by P1, and we get zero for either A prime or B prime. So that means that either P1 divides all the coefficients of A prime, or P1 divides all the coefficients of B prime. And here, when we say divides, we mean like divides in R. That every coefficient of A prime is in the ideal generated by P1, or every coefficient of B prime is in the ideal generated by P1. All right, so what's the idea now? We're going to cancel out this factor of P1. So there's a factor of P1 on the left-hand side, and now we're gonna see that there's also one on the right-hand side. In the first case, what we can do is replace A prime with P1 times 1 over P1 times A prime of X. 1 over P1 times A prime of X is still going to be in R bracket X if P1 divides all the coefficients of A prime. And then we'll have a P1 here, a P1 here, and we can cancel. Same idea in the second case. If P1 divides all the coefficients in B prime of X, 1 over P1 times B prime of X also now has coefficients in R bracket X, and we have a P1 that we can cancel on both sides. So this argument is very, very near being completed. We'll be able to cancel this P1 here. And just arguing the same way, we're able to cancel all of the irreducible factors of D. So I'll pause and erase and just write a few last things about this argument. Let's complete this proof. So we saw that either this irreducible P1 that divides D, it either divides all of the coefficients of A prime of X, or it divides all of the coefficients of B prime of X. Either way, we can now take a factor of P1 out of that polynomial, all of whose coefficients are divisible by P1, and we can cancel that from both sides of this equation. So we can cancel this factor of P1, and what we get is D prime, which is D, but without that factor of P1, times P of X equals A double prime of X times B double prime of X, where what are these polynomials? One of them just is the same, either A prime or B prime. And the other one is the same, except we've pulled out a factor of P1 from all of the coefficients in Yeah, in one of these polynomials. And this is a product of two polynomials in R bracket X, and they have the same degrees still as the corresponding polynomials we started with, A of X and B of X. So in particular, capital A of X and capital B of X in F bracket X. So in particular, they're non-constant. Okay, so we just continue in this way. We do the same thing now with the next irreducible factor of D, or the first irreducible factor of D prime, if you prefer. And we'll see that we can cancel all the irreducible factors of D. So what happens when you have no irreducible factors left is that this thing multiplying P of X over on the left-hand side is a unit. So what we get is a unit times P of X equals A of X times B of X, where these are non-constant polynomials in R bracket X. We multiply both sides by the inverse of this unit, and that completes the proof.